Hey there, I'm Lee Ullman here with some big news from the National Young Farmers Coalition. We're partnering with Heritage Radio Network on a special season of The Farm Report. It's all about what's happening with the Farm Bill and how it impacts farmers and eaters.
I am growing diversified vegetables on land that's been in our family for 150 years.
And so with the pandemic, gentrification, property values going up, we had to sell the land and we lost it.
Join us as we uncover the untold stories behind this massive piece of legislation that shapes how we grow our food, what we eat, and so much more.
The problems we have had, those are things that come from earlier Farm Bill and USDA policy, right? Like Earl Butts, get big or get out.
You know, it's my responsibility to know not only what I'm eating, but then like how that all came to be and realize like, wow, like this piece of legislation, all this money, like it's technically something that I support as a taxpayer.
While Congress debates the next Farm Bill, this is not just an invitation to listen. It's a call to action. Be part of the conversation. Subscribe to the Farm Report on Heritage Radio Network, wherever you listen to podcasts.
This program is brought to you by Chefs Collaborative, a nonprofit with a mission to inspire, educate, and celebrate chefs and food professionals building a better food system. Change menus, change lives. Learn more at chefscollaborative.org.
You're listening to Heritage Radio Network. We're a member-supported food radio network, broadcasting over 35 weekly shows live from Bushwick, Brooklyn. Join our hosts as they lead you through the world of craft brewing, behind the scenes of the restaurant industry, inside the battle over school food, and beyond. Find us at heritageradionetwork.org.
We talk about food. We talk about music with musical dudes. Finger on the pulse. Snacky tunes.
Father likes to be right. Says he found. Says he trauma cross the line.
Hello, and welcome to Snacky Tunes. I'm one half your host, Greg Bresnitz. We have Darren Bresnitz calling in from Los Angeles. That was just Diane Birch, who will be live in studio, talking about her time in Berlin and her EP. Please stay tuned for that. But up first, we have a very quickly returning guest, Jameson Fink. Welcome back.
Great to be back.
Wine Enthusiast Magazine. You thought it was a year. It was actually July that you were on this past time. And you just got back from Miami.
Yeah, I was there for our Wine Enthusiast Wine Star Awards. It's the first time we held it in Miami. And it was lovely to be enjoying some 70-plus degree weather and sunshine.
Was there any upsets?
Upsets, well, they're all they're announced in advance, so everyone knows who won. So I wouldn't think there's no upsets. It's just, you know, when the whole list comes out of the nominees, it's pretty exciting for everyone to be nominated, and it's a great community of people supporting each other and just congratulating each other. So it's a very brings the industry together.
Were there any secret hotel wine parties where people were just opening big bottles that, like, you know, you had to kind of be in the know to get a sip of or get a taste of?
There may have been parties like that, but the invitations were wide open and everyone was welcome.
Okay. Well, you are here today to join us to talk about the 10 best wine travel destinations of 2017. You did 2016 last year, and you are back with a brand new Where to Go. We're back, based on wine. So what was the impetus for creating this list?
Well, I think, you know, I mean, obviously the magazine is called Wine Enthusiast, but people who are interested in wine have a lot of varied interests too, and travel is certainly one of them. And, you know, nothing's, you know, in my journey in wine, the thing that I value the most is travel and going to vineyards, going to wineries all over the country, all over the world. And that's when, you know, I mean, I'm a sentimental, corny guy, but I don't think it's corny. I mean, that's when you really, like, you know, learn and understand, and, you know, where your feet are on the ground, walking the vineyards and talking with winemakers and people who work there. That's when it's really exciting. So I think the impetus for the wine travel, the best 10, is just to showcase how much a part of travel is a part of understanding and enjoying wine.
So obviously there are, you know, there could be 10, 20, 30, 40, 50 places in the world to travel. What separates the top 10 from the rest?
Well, you're absolutely right. I mean, we could do, you know, a top 100. I think what it is every year is that it's sort of a balance. I mean, there are I mean, look, there are places we could do every year. There are iconic places that you would want to visit all over the world. But I think it's a mix of sort of taking a new look at some of the classic places, like, you know, like not just Napa, but let's look at Calistoga, and then discovering some places that might surprise some of our readers, like the Canary Islands. So it's to me, it's each year it's an exercise in let's look at what's, you know, somewhat undiscovered and shine a spotlight on that. And let's also maybe take a fresh look at this is why you should revisit the classics.
And the list is really good. You have where to stay, where to dine, where to visit. Do the wines, is that where you start? It has to have good wines, or does the travel and the surrounding areas and activities also play a big factor in it?
Well, I would say it has to have good wines, but then I think about London, which I think is a great example this year, because I don't think I'm going to say something provocative when I say that London is not known for its vineyards.
I mean, you had Las Vegas on last
right,
year as well,
exactly.
Which no one really – I saw that, and I was like, okay – this is definitely a different approach to this list.
Right. And it's just a great place, like being like Las Vegas or here in New York or London. They're just great centers for people who love to drink wine. I mean, you can go to places like Las Vegas or New York or London and just drink, just have like, you know, you're at sort of like one of the universal centers of wine. And so I think London's a destination like that, where it's like, yes, you may not be strolling through vineyards, but you're going to have a, you know, a world of wine from everything from like, you know, cool, funky stuff to the classics to, you know, everything in between. And also it can, you know, we can give a nod to English sparkling wine, which is something that's really up and coming too, and that you have a chance. I mean, it's being imported and it's getting to be more available, you know, nationally, but that's a great place to go and explore that.
Because you also talk about just going not to London, but the outskirts of London and using that as your jumping off point.
Yeah, exactly. And a lot of these can be a great kind of home base for your wine exploration, a lot of these destinations too.
Now, you know, when putting together, and you say that you're not going to put Napa Valley, you're not going to put Loire Valley and things like that, are you trying to sort of push the conversation in a way that, you know, opens it up to people who might be exploring new places for wines? Or are you just trying to do it to sort of like be like, okay, we're going to say this and then hope we get some comments back? Because, you know, putting a place like London on the list is obviously going to generate some sort of commentary in the wine world.
Yeah, I think so. And it's not that we're, you know, say not going to do Loire Valley or Napa. I mean, those are, I mean, I would love to be in both those places.
Oh my
right
God,
now.
Right now?
Yeah.
Let's go. Let's
but maybe sort of like taking, like looking at a smaller section of it, like we did this year with Calistoga and Napa, or, you know, with the Loire Valley, maybe we would focus on one particular, probably we'd focus on, let's say, like Sancerre or something like that, or, you know, an area around there. So I think it's more of a, you know, it's like we want it to be about discovery and people, but mm-hmm. it might be about rediscovery mm-hmm. too. It might be like, hey, let's take a new look at a classic. They're doing these new things there. Maybe they have new restaurants or new hotels or new activities to do, or it's just, you know, hey, you know what, this place deserves a, you know, the spotlight again. So it's kind of a combination of those things, discovery and rediscovery.
Let's take one step.
Oh, sorry. Just quick question. Did you discover any new wine that you didn't know about when you're putting this list together?
Well, I still haven't. I mean, I know it has a long, you know, storied history of wine production, but Bulgaria is a place where I don't, if I've had a Bulgarian wine, it's been a long time. And so to me, yeah, I mean, I look at that list. I mean, I don't know everything too. And like, I get excited when I see sure. these lists or when people nominate things too. And it does spur, I think, a discovery. Like, you know, I mean, even like, you know, even if you can't go there, maybe you'll say like, wow, I didn't know this about the long history of winemaking in Bulgaria. And I'm going to go to a wine shop and say, hey, do you have a Bulgarian wine? I'd really like to try one. So I think that's a really good point. And that's an aspect of it too. If you can't, you know, kind of go to these places, you can explore it through a bottle of wine. And that's, you know, another one of the great things about wine.
Where does the nomination process start, and how long do people start lobbying for their places or suggestions or kind of side conversations?
Yeah, it's one of those things where, I mean, it's a total group effort. We have everyone in the office. I mean, we travel a lot. I mean, our managing editor, Joe Cherwinski, is in New Zealand as we speak. And we're, you know, a lot of us are traveling all over the country and all over the world. We have our contributing editors on the West Coast and people in Europe. And then, of course, we have a lot of, you know, contacts and friends and colleagues that we ask too. So, yeah, it's sort of like a year-round thing. And then once it gets closer to putting the issue together, you know, in the months in advance, we start, you know, trying to narrow it down. And, you know, kind of like you hinted at earlier, I mean, it could be 20, 30, 40, 50, 100. So I mean, it's not easy, and it's definitely something that we put a lot of thought into and a lot of time into. And so it's really it's fun. It's a lot of work, but it's definitely, you know, we're really proud of it.
All right, so let's get into the list. You had mentioned Canary Islands, which, when you think of Spanish wine, is not the first place you think of where wine's grown. But what makes Canary Islands so legendary? In fact, so legendary, it's been around since, you say, since the time of Shakespeare.
Yeah, well, that's definitely part of it. And I think just looking at the terrain, this, like, volcanic, black volcanic soil, and these, it's just amazing the way the vines grow in kind of like these, like, half circles, like, semi-buried in the, below the surface of the soil. It's just really spectacular. It's like a lunar landscape for wine, almost. It's really otherworldly. And I think there's also something just to be said for, this is me personally speaking, islands, just like, you know, like Sicily, which is also mm-hmm. on our list, or going to Tasmania, or going to Santorini. There's just something, I think, just really appealing about, you know, visiting, or Madeira, you know, visiting an island that produces wine. It's just, it's like something out of a wish book.
And how would you describe the wine if, for people who've never had it from there, what would you say the notes are, and what wine that's a little bit more common that you could equate it to?
I haven't had a ton of wine from the Canary Islands. The ones I've had have kind of that kind of classic, kind of minerally, a little saline quality to them. I would think they'd be like, I think if you kind of like, something like, it's not like Chablis at all, but if you like sort of like mineral-driven wines with that kind of sea spray component, that those mm-hmm. would be wines, like really dry, bracing, and, when I say unusual, it's not a euphemism for anything. I say like just unusual in the best way, like they're like, wow, that's really cool. That's something I haven't had before. That's really unique. So I'm just, like I said, just like with a lot of these other regions, I mean, I myself, and you know, that's what I love about wine too. Like there's like, I don't know everything. I'm always learning new things. And that's what's great about a group effort like this, is that everyone around the country and the world brings something to the table.
We're going to take a quick musical break, and we're going to come back and look at some of these other cities and places on the list. We have a track up from Alex Rose, who just put out two songs this week. Make sure to go check him out on our Bandcamp and SoundCloud page, and we'll be right back on Snacky Tunes.
I'm flesh. I'm business. Touch me, I am sick. I am strong. I am lustful in this abyss. I am neither formed. I am not full. I'm a great divide. All is amiss. So kiss me, baby. Tell me, Judas, are you my priest? Kiss me, baby, while I'm wild and free. And tell me, Judas, are you my priest? Open my mouth to impurities. Open my throat, let in the bees, so they can buzz and busy me. And kiss me, baby, while I'm wild and free. And tell me, Judas, are you my priest? Just kiss me, baby.
Welcome back. Alex Rose, check out her new tracks over on her Bandcamp and SoundCloud page. Let's bring this back to the States. Hood River.
Bring it back to the States.
Hood River.
America.
I went to school at Eugene, Oregon, and was totally unaware of the great wine that was around me. The microbrew scene was huge, but I was never even went to winery when I was there, and always felt a pang of regret not realizing how great Oregon was for wine. And you mentioned that Willamette Valley just won at the Winestar Awards.
Yes, for the Wine Region of the Year, yeah.
So let's talk about Hood River. What makes it great? Why that area? What are the attributes that you could find in the wines in that place?
Well, it's more like like we talked about earlier, it's a great home base for exploring. You're right, the beer there is great, like Full Sail and Freem, and it's right on the water, it's right on the river. You've got all the people parasailing, and it's very scenic. I think the interesting thing is that you can explore wineries on both the Oregon and Washington side. Like you can get in your car and go to Sincline, which makes some really cool wines, sparkling wines. They make a cool Gruner Veltliner, a bunch of other things too. And then you've got wineries like Phelps Creek comes to mind. They have just a one of the nicest views I've ever seen from a winery. It's very idyllic, and they do a nice Pinot Noir and Chardonnay too. So it's one of those spots where you've got, and that's another thing I think we try and highlight with these destinations too. It's like, drink wine, go to wineries, taste wine. But it's also that you can, if you are into, active outdoor sports, like Hood River is an amazing place. If you like beer, if you want to explore a distillery, or if you want to just kind of like chill and walk through this charming town right on the water, right on the river, you can do that too. So I think that's kind of a factor that we talk about too, is that that whole kind of lifestyle experience. Like, yes, wine is, kind of a central part to it, but part of the charm of all these destinations is that the options that you have. And I think that's the way, a lot of people like myself, I want to travel, is I don't just want to kind of go to like six wineries in one day and, be in tasting rooms all day. Like, I want to go outside. I want to walk around. Maybe I want to have a beer after tasting a ton of huge tannic red wines and things like that.
Right,
so I think
right,
Hood
right.
River is really emblematic of that. It's a really charming spot.
How long of a time period do you recommend for these trips? 3 days, 5 days, a month, a year?
Well, that's really funny. I was just talking to a friend of mine last night who was talking about taking a vacation. She's like, yeah, I think I'm going to be there for 3 days. I'm like, 3 days? That's crazy. Like, you got, and she was including travel time in that. I'm like, look, you got to spend 5 days and 5 days, feet on the ground, not like, 2 days on traveling. So I think some of the places, you can, hey, if you can stay, like a month, that would be amazing. But yeah, I think a lot of places, I personally would want to take at least a week. I don't like to be sort of like, overbooked and like National Lampoon's Vacation. Like, there's a Grand Canyon. You look at it. Okay, time to go. So I think, if you have if you're able to be leisurely in your travels, I think that's the way to go.
I mean, with two of the 10 places on here based in the U.S., can we just put to rest any conversation about American wine not being on the global level of wine producers everywhere?
Oh yeah, and I feel like that's something that's been settled a while. Yeah, absolutely. I mean, everything from the Finger Lakes to the Willamette Valley to Washington State and obviously California too. And even look at places like Maryland, Texas, Virginia. I mean, there's some really good wine being made all over the country. So, it's a great time to be drinking wine.
So another place that you pick that's on the list is Sicily in Italy. And what happens in Sicily for this Italian wine that doesn't happen in other parts of the country that might be better known for wine?
Well, I think one of it is, Italy has an incredible wealth of indigenous grapes. I just think, like, with Sicily, there's a book I really like called The World of Sicilian Wine, and I think that kind of encapsulates it, that, and I'm probably quoting straight from this book, it's like the world of Sicilian wine is kind of a world unto its own. There's just so much diversity on that island that it's astonishing. Like, from Mount Etna, you've got these really cool red wines made from Nerello Mascalese that some people say are kind of, Nebbiolo-ish or Barolo-ish, and maybe some that are, Burgundy-esque. And these, beautiful white wines made from Caraconte. And then you've got, Ceresuolo di Vittoria, which is Frappato and Nero d'Avola, or just Frappato on itself, and you've got Marsala and sweet wines, and there's just so much there that's just really exciting. And I just think that the food, just and the whole thing of just being on an island, that the lifestyle is You know, you can explore beaches, you can see volcanoes, there's incredible historic ruins, there's top restaurants. It's just a really, it's a really awesome place to visit.
This one sounds much, much like more of an adventure than some of the other places where you're going to get the full breadth of the country enveloped within the wine tasting as well.
Yeah, absolutely. Yes, absolutely. I think it's a place where you want to explore around and spend more time and visit, you know, all the coasts, you know, the islands off the island and the interior. Yeah, I mean, you could spend a lot of time. And that's where I would say spend, you know, don't do it in 3 days.
Spend the month.
Yeah, take the month. Why not?
Take the month.
Yeah.
The last one we want to touch on is Rheingau, Germany, which is right outside Frankfurt, a place near and dear to my heart. Let's talk about this because this looks like your traditional German, what you would think of in the storytale, fairy tale type of village that also produces great wine.
Yeah, that's a place I haven't been, but yes, I mean, the village is dotting the river. Yeah, it's sort of like the archetype of super, you know, super charming wine country with traditional villages and things like that. And yeah, I'd love to go there and drink a bunch of Rieslings, and then I could get some Frankfurt tips from you guys.
And is there anything in the town that you can call it, or anything from an overarching theme from this that you think is really just pulling and pointing these destinations, and that will also begin to inform the 2018 list?
Of course. I think every year we kind of learn something more from it, but I think it's just having that mix of like places that are kind of not in the middle of nowhere, but like where you're really like you're really kind of embedded in the vineyards. You're right there, having like a place that's an urban experience, like London or Las Vegas, where you can you're not in vineyards, but you have like everything at your fingertips. It's like a, you know, you're like a kid in a candy store with all these restaurants and wine bars and wine shops. So I think it's having, and then just places that are just, you know, I mean, most places that have vineyards are pretty scenic, but I think also having something, you know, where you can access the ocean or do a lot of other things like go hiking or biking or there are spas or things like that. So I think it's having a mix of like all those kinds of experiences just so the list is diverse and exciting. And, you know, like I said, like this year's list, there are new discoveries for me. I'm like, oh, wow, that place is cool. I want to go there. I want to drink those wines. So I think just, you know, also keeping in mind that next year, you know, we got to, you know, you got to sleuth out those places as well.
And for the uninitiated who have never done a winery vacation, how much time would you allocate per winery?
That's a great question. I think you have this excitement like, I want to go to a winery. Let's go to another. I would rather do less than more because I don't like sort of like clock watching and being like, ooh, we got to drive and get to this next
sip,
place.
Sip, spit, go.
For me, the magic number is 3. I like to do 1 in the morning, like palate's really fresh, you know, like 10 in the morning, spend a couple hours there, go someplace that has a restaurant or a restaurant adjacent and have a nice long lunch. And then go to one more place in the afternoon. You're not rushed because you want to have, if you're in wine country, have a long lunch. That's one of the greatest pleasures in life. So then after that lunch, you go to one more place and you're there for a couple hours and then you're done. Then you go back to the hotel and you put up your feet and you have a beer.
Great. Well, where can people find the list, get the magazine, start to book travel, take us with them, be tour guides?
It's, first of all, the website is winemag.com. And if you're looking for the travel guide specifically, for 2017, it's winemag.com/2017winetravel.
And you can also find the 2016 list if you happen to find yourself in Las Vegas and dying for a good bottle of wine.
Yeah, check it. That's still very valid.
Well, Jameson, thanks for joining us. We will probably have you back on sooner than either of us can expect.
And I'll try and remember exactly when it was last time.
Up next, we have Diane Bird.
We'll just say February, first week in February every year.
Deal.
Great. We have Diane Birch up next live in studio. We have a track that she played on from our buddy Aaron Rewards that was recorded on Snacky Tunes 4 years ago, 5 years ago, something like that. Aaron, if you're out there floating wherever you are, we say hello. Stay tuned.
Hello.
We'll be right back.
This program is brought to you by Chefs Collaborative, a national nonprofit network with a mission to inspire, educate, and celebrate chefs and food professionals building a better food system. Chefs Collaborative members work to make sustainable practices second nature for every chef in the United States. Chefs Collaborative was founded in 1993 by visionary chefs including Rick Bayless and Alice Waters, who acknowledged the influential role of food professionals on our food choices, our collective personal health, the vitality of cultures, and the integrity of the global environment. Chefs Collaborative believes that the greater culinary community can be a catalyst for positive change by expanding the market for good food and helping to preserve local farming and fishing communities. Change menus, change lives. Learn more about Chefs Collaborative at chefscollaborative.org.
Welcome back. Diane, welcome to Snacky Tunes.
Thank you. Thanks for having me.
It's good to see you again.
Thank you. Yes, you too.
You were the child of a nomadic preacher in Zimbabwe. How did that affect your musical inclinations, and where do you pull influence from those experiences?
I mean, I think the fact that I had to move around so much as a small child, and so I was kind of always like having to adapt to a lot of different things, saying goodbye a lot of times to people. So I sort of became a little bit of a recluse in my own mind. And my parents were also a lot older. And this was also in South Africa. So it was like, you know, there's like a lot of backwards. There's a lot of backwards. Yeah. So, it really influenced my music, I guess, just because I started appreciating music so much. My parents were big classical fans, and there was a lot of music in church growing up, so I was very influenced by like church hymns and classical music, and I was very sheltered also, so it made me a little weird.
When did you start playing the piano?
I was 7 when I started playing, yeah. And I was just sort of not that interested. I mean, my mom was like, oh, we're going to a piano lesson today. I was like, okay. And then it was just kind of like one of those things where I just, it just came naturally, and I just loved it so much.
And at that time, or it was at that time, or no, or how much later in life did you start to realize that music is what you wanted to do full time?
Well, I always knew that music was what I wanted to do full time, which is why I always use the excuse, I don't need a college degree. I don't need to finish high school. I'm like, I'm just going to play music.
I don't need to do homework. I don't need to do any of this stuff.
No.
I got the piano.
Yeah, like, I already know what I'm supposed to do. Yeah. I always knew I was going to do music. I didn't know. I had no idea I was going to become a singer. I thought I just had, like, the worst voice. But I prided myself on the fact that I was a pianist. And I'm like, I'm a pianist. I want people to take me seriously as a pianist. And then people were like, why don't you just, don't you sing? And I was like, no. And then they're like, oh, never mind. And I was like, nobody wants me if I don't sing. So then I started trying to sing. And, yeah, I'm still trying to sing.
Which pianists or classical composers were your people growing up?
Well, like Glenn Gould and Leonard Bernstein. I mean, just like all the classical, you know, pianists. And then when I started to get more, and I mean, of course, like Debussy and Chopin and, you know, Satie and those composers, I was very influenced by as well. And I loved like old film scores and like, you know, that kind of feel. And so a lot of contemporary composers as well. And so I was just, yeah, I wanted to just kind of be like a film scorer or just like compose like weird contemporary classical piano pieces. And then I'm like, that's kind of weird. Maybe
that's really niche.
Maybe that's kind of niche.
Very niche.
As you evolved into this, did playing in piano lobby in a hotel lobby's pianos help you get over the I'm not a singer to the singer that you are now?
Well, it wasn't really that, but although it did really kind of make me not give as much of a... Am I allowed to say?
Yeah.
I'm like, is this a PG show here? exactly. It kind of made me, like, not care so much. Give as much of a shit. But it definitely made me more aware of, like, music and what was going on and pop music. I started paying more attention and... but then singing, it was more just my friend one day was like, oh, I'm going to this singing class and it's really great. We like talk about our feelings and hold hands and then we meditate and he has a piano and you should come over and play like background music. And I was like, okay. And then I went there and I ended up writing a song for this class just as like a fun exercise. And then they were like, oh, this is really good. And then I just started doing it.
What songs were introduced to you from the pop world when you started playing in the hotels? Or how far away from you from like what was going on contemporary music?
Well, when I first started doing it, I mean, I've sort of always lived in my own world of like reality. Like I pay attention to certain things and not others. But when I started playing in hotels and restaurants, I was like, okay, I have to learn the standards. So I have to learn like all the classic, you know, Cole Porter, Gershwin, whatever. And then I started playing that and I was like, okay, this is really cool, but like, I want to play some other songs and I love Radiohead and I love, you know, all these other pop, you know, anything that I was listening to at the time. And I was like, oh, I could just play any of these on the piano and just sort of make it sound. I just lounged everything out basically. And I was like, everything works. You can lounge anything out. You can lounge out Chopin if you want, or Beethoven.
Ooh, a little loungy Chopin.
What is it?
A little loungy Chopin.
Yeah, exactly. You can pretty much, yeah, put a grace note on anything.
Can we hear a song?
Yes, please. Quickly, before I start saying too much stupid shit.
What are you going to play for us first?
I'll play a song called Kings of Queens. It's actually inspired by the Mets, which I have no interest in, really. But my boyfriend does. And he was talking about it very passionately. And I was like, wow, this is so like poetic and beautiful. And, you know, I turned it into a song, so... Yeah, I'll go ahead and play that. Kings of Queens.
the feeling we still believe in.
You left America in your nomadic travels to go to Berlin. What was the decision behind that, and what did you find there for musical inspiration?
I'd sort of just fallen out of love with New York. I'd been here for quite a few years. I was sick of my rent price. I was just sick. I had a dynamic with it that was like, I needed to just shift it up. So the opportunity came to go there and just live for like 10 months to a year. And so there was just like this apartment that we knew through a friend. And so we ended up just being like, yeah, let's go. And it was great. It sort of reinvigorated my idea of music, and just there's all these great studios, and there's like this amazing German gear, and everything works really well.
Efficient.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, it was just it's a really beautiful city. I mean, we had a really nice apartment. I just stayed inside all day long and just wrote songs, and just the feeling there, it has a real creative community, and it just kind of took me out of like the pressure and everything of New York, and sort of brought me back to like this really quiet place where I sort of just figured out what I wanted to do next.
Most people know Berlin for its late night techno and dance music and 72-hour clubs. What is the more piano focused singer songwriter scene like there, and how is that?
I mean, I don't hang out. I was at the Berghain like every night, like jamming on the dance floor. No, I'm kidding. I wasn't. I don't really know. I was pretty reclusive. I didn't really check out like what was going on, and like that's. I don't even know what's going on in any singer songwriter scene anywhere, really. I didn't listen to a ton of music or go see a ton of music. There's a lot of things that the city had to offer that I didn't really make the most use of, but for me it was more just about being there, being in that space and that environment. I met great musicians. I sort of tailor-made the whole experience to what I needed at that point in my life.
So let's talk about the new album, New, and how it came together. And you mentioned that it was a reclaiming of creative control. Yes. How did that happen, and why did that happen, and how did the new album come together?
I was on a label for, you know, 7-8 years, and sure. There was a lot of creative battles that were fought, and when I left them a couple years ago, it was kind of, I started just learning Ableton, and I was like, I'm going to do everything myself. No one's coming near anything I ever do ever again. And
back off.
Everything.
I'm
like, I got this. I'll do everything. And I'm also a control freak. So it was like a great way for me to realize that actually that's not always the best thing. But I just started writing all these songs. I had like all these things in my Ableton that I was like, what am I going to do with this stuff? And so it slowly started coming together. And then when we went to Berlin, my boyfriend was just like, you know, oh, there's all these studios here, and I know this person who can introduce you to that person, and there's musicians, and why don't we just like record a bunch of the songs? And I was like, I don't know, like, you know, money, da 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 da. And then he was just like, let's just do it, and then just self-release it, and, you know, start a label. And I don't know, he's like, let's just do this. And so I was like, okay, let's do it. And so it was just kind of those things, like, it was so simple. I just made this decision, like, yeah, you're going to do this. You're going to record it, and you're going to put it up on Bandcamp, and you're not going to make a big deal about it, and you're just going to sell it to your fans. And so
awesome.
Yeah, and so it was just incredible. I mean, I came from the mastering studio, and within like an hour, they were uploaded onto Bandcamp, and it was released, and people were buying it, and like the money was going into my PayPal account, and I'm like, this has never happened in like my entire career.
God,
I've never seen a dime.
The internet, right?
I know, and it was just like, it's incredible because artists are so powerful, and we have such tools now, you know, with being able to, you know, have this direct line of contact to our fan base and have the support. There is like, there's all these things that we can do, and we don't actually need, you know, this whole machine necessarily around us in the way that maybe in the past it was much more enticing. So it definitely made me feel powerful and just like, yeah, I can do what I want. And when you put on the business hat, which is hard to do sometimes,
right.
You realize you have a lot of power.
What are some of the things that you still feel that you need to learn as now having your own label, or things that are still not totally there that you had from the support of being on a label before?
Well, obviously, like, the money. The money thing is nice, but as I've come to realize, like, you know, more money, more problems, obviously.
I've heard that before.
Yeah, you know, it's this thing. I coined it myself. Yeah. Once you have a lot of people in the mix and you have all these other opinions, and it's very difficult to, like, retain your artistic vision. And sometimes your vision just shifts and it changes, and you need to be surrounding yourself with people that you really trust and that are on the same page as you. But yeah, financially, you know, that's one of the harder things. But at the same time, I have so many, like, friends. I have such a community. There's such a, like, heavy, you know, deep artistic community of people that are very generous with their time, with their creativity. And, like, I pull in favors. I have so many people that are just like, we want to help you. We want to do this for you. And when you don't have that big label behind you, actually people feel more compelled to do stuff for you, because they're like, oh, you're doing something. We believe in this. We're passionate about it. And we believe in it, and we want to support this for the right reasons, not just because we think we're going to make a buck. And it just brings it back to, like, the integrity of the intention of what you're doing again. And it's been really good to.
That's awesome. Well, let's get into the mix with another song. How about that?
Sure. This next song is "Stand Under My Love." I guess I'll play that one.
Sure.
Okay, it feels like maybe a fitting song for these insane times we're living in right now. all right. Somebody on the left, somebody on the right. Somebody in the dark, somebody in the light. Harder than stone, make you feel so all alone. The drugs don't work, there's too much hurt. Gotta find another road. Gotta bear the heavy load. Somehow, big sky come crashing down. There has to be a place for us in this world. With a little shelter. From up above, little eyes at every turn. I wanna be the face you trust in this world. When you need a little shelter, stand under my love. Stone, and the future may be known.
when there's nothing left to say. I'll cover you, I'll cover you, babe. Together we'll last for another day. Big sky come crashing down. There has to be a place for us in this world. With a little shelter from up above, little eyes at every turn. I wanna be the face you trust in this world. When you need a little shelter, I stand under my love. Oh, stand under my love. Ooh, you can stand.
Let's talk about the real reason why you're here. Cream of the crib.
Oh, God. Oh, yes.
Peasant dishes made with royal ingredients. Your food Instagram profile.
Oh, yes, which I haven't updated in a minute.
Well, here's a
good reason.
This is
to.
Actually an intervention from your team to bring you back into the food world.
Yeah.
It's a beautiful sight.
Oh, thanks.
Did you make all the food yourself?
Yeah, duh.
What was the inspiration behind it, and how did it evolve?
Well, first of all, I love food. I love to eat. I love good ingredients. I love high quality ingredients. I don't know how to cook really at all. But I just like to put certain things together. I used to live across the street from Marlowe and Sons in Williamsburg, and also from their place, Marlowe and Daughters, which has like really beautiful produce and stuff. And so I was always in there, and like they had all these great dishes, and I was like, oh, that's an interesting way to do eggs, and that's an interesting concoction, and oh yeah, I should try that. And then I ended up just sort of trying things out, and then I'm like, that's so pretty, I should photograph it. And then I'm like, where do I put this? It's like, I can't put it on my Instagram because that's lame. And I'm like, I'm just going to start a food Instagram, and nobody's even going to pay attention, but it's going to look pretty when I scroll through, and I want to remember my recipes.
It's really pretty. You have a great roasted
chicken. Really pretty. It's beautifully shot.
Thank you.
Is that also shot by yourself?
Well, yeah. I mean, I have an art director, and we've, you know, discussed it at length. But, yeah, no, it's some iPhone simple side. The plate sort of at a slight angle, and, yeah.
Nice natural light. So you have a show coming up this Wednesday at Babies?
It's actually Tuesday.
Tuesday at Babies.
Yeah.
Who are you playing with?
I have a really great band. It's like a full-on band. I have a little string section. I have Stuart Matthewman, the sax player of the Sade band. He's playing with me. Aaliyah is playing with me. And so it's going to be exciting.
Although no one could see where you pointed because it's radio.
Oh, I'm so sorry.
The bass. The silent bass player.
The silent bass player.
Silent bass player.
Yes.
That's great. So where can people find the EP, find the records, put money in your PayPal account?
Yeah, well, you can buy it you can get it everywhere. You can, if you like, I recommend buying it on Bandcamp because you can get high quality audio files. And you just go...
Shout out to Bandcamp. Who doesn't love Bandcamp?
I know. It's incredible, actually.
And they just donated all their sales on Friday to the ACLU.
Really?
Yeah.
I did not even know that.
Oh, yeah.
Okay. I love me. Only buy it on Bandcamp, please. Yes. Thanks.
Yeah.
Yeah. So even more reason, I would be totally happy to have them take all the proceeds from that and give it to ACLU.
And you also have a European tour coming up as well.
Yeah, I'm leaving February. I'm going to go play some shows, and I'm playing in Berlin and Paris and London, and then, yeah, going back again in May. I'm working on a full-length album now with Aaliyah. He's my producer on it. It's exciting. We're excited to play shows and get back out there.
Last question.
Yep.
What advice would you give to people who want to take back more and more control of their musical projects? And what are some of the hardest things that you faced along the way that you got through and that you would just give some advice to newcomers?
Just figure out a way to get the money. Like, never don't do something because of money. I feel like there's always a way to get, like, a little chunk of change or pull in a favor. Yeah. And you make the money back and, you know, just keep doing it. Keep informing your fans. Just believe that, like, there's people out there that actually care. And don't get swept up in the whole thing that if you don't have all this team of people around you paying you tons of attention and showering you with praise, that that's the only type of scenario that's going to get you into the, you know, into the, you know, public eye or whatever. I don't know. I don't really know what advice. I'd have to think about it a little.
No, that was good advice.
That was perfect.
But just basically do it. Just do it. You'll figure it all out. Everything will happen for you. I mean, the other little side note is that I like engineered and I produced and I mixed a lot of Noose, which was totally intimidating, but just like power through it and then you learn and then you keep getting better and better. And, you know, everybody starts at a certain point. Everybody's an amateur at some point. So just,
I like to say that Judah Child at one point didn't know how to make eggs.
Really?
Yeah.
Awesome.
Yeah.
And then she watched the Jacques Pepin YouTube tutorial.
Yeah, that, exactly. Yeah, that's exactly how it happened. Alternative cooking facts. Well, we want to thank Jameson for coming on. Please make sure to check out Wine Enthusiast Magazine to the 2017 Best Wine Travel Destinations. Diane, good to see you again. Thank you so much for coming on. We will be back next week with a brand new all LA-based episode of Snacky Tunes. What are you going to take us out with?
I'm going to play a song called Juno, inspired by that epic snowstorm when they shut the city down a few years ago.
Oh, yeah.
Great. Well, thanks for listening.
Thank you.
And we will be back next week with a brand new episode of Snacky Tunes.
Cool. Thank you.
Stay home, saving the arms of a lover. We barely come back from the summer. I wanna watch the sky coming down like it's the end, like it's the end. Somehow somehow.
We talk about food, we talk about music, with musical dudes, finger on the pulse, snacky tunes.
Thanks for listening to Heritage Radio Network, food radio supported by you. For our freshest content and to hear about exclusive events, subscribe to our newsletter. Enter your email at the bottom of our website, heritageradionetwork.org. Connect with us on Facebook, Instagram, and Twitter at @heritage_radio. Heritage Radio Network is a nonprofit organization driving conversations to make the world a better, fairer, more delicious place. And we couldn't do it without support from listeners like you. Want to be a part of the food world's most innovative community? Rate the shows you like, tell your friends, and please join our community by becoming a member. Just click on the beating heart at the top right of our homepage. Thanks for listening.